Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of 2015. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members will refer to tablets during the course of the meeting because we provide papers in digital format. No apologies have been received for this meeting. I welcome George Adam to the committee. He replaces Claire Adamson, who has left us to join the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. I'd like to thank Claire for all her hard work on the committee and say how much we're looking forward to working with George. And agenda item one is to ask George if he has any relevant interests to declare. Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Refer you to my published declaration of interest, but also add that I was down as a member of Renfrewshire Leisure Trust. I haven't been a member since May 2012 because it was a Renfrewshire Council appointment, so just to make sure that you're aware of that.
Thank you very much for that, and we'll move on to agenda item two, which is our main item of business today. It's to take evidence as part of our inquiry into fixed odds betting terminals. We're doing this in a round table format as it allows us to hear from as many people as possible in the short time we have available to us. I welcome Councillor John McAlpine, representing Argyll and Bute Council, John Heaton, the Association of British Bookmakers, Miles Barron, the Bingo Association, Simon Storer, British Amusement Catering Trade Association, Adrian Parkinson, campaign...
Matthew Zarb Cousin, I'm standing in for Adrian today, just Matthew, for the benefit of the clerk. Yeah, Matt Zarb Cousin, Zarb hyphen Cousin. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Paul Rooney of Glasgow City Council, Simon Thomas of the Hippodrome Casino, Stephen McGowan of the Law Society of Scotland, Soteris Scholarios, National Casino Forum, and Andrew Lyman of William Hill. Before I start, I'd like to just set out some of the ground rules for the discussion, as we have a lot of participants here today, and I want to ensure that everyone gets the opportunity to participate. So I'd be grateful if you could indicate to me when you want to speak, and I'll call the speakers in order. I'd also ask you to be mindful that this discussion is being recorded, and so you must ensure that the audio operator has time to switch the microphones on before you begin to speak. You don't have to touch any buttons, they will switch the microphones on for you. Saying all that, we do want the session to be as informal as possible, and we'll try to ensure that as many of you can contribute. And I would appeal to members as well to keep your contributions short too. Finally, as it's Remembrance Day today, the committee will conclude its session around about 10:45 to allow members to attend the commemoration event being held in the garden lobby. Anyone remaining in this room is welcome to observe a private two-minute silence. I'll kick off the discussion by asking the question, the devil's advocate question, if you like. Are FOBTs the crack cocaine of gambling or harmless entertainment? And who would like to kick off in that one? Andrew Lyman, please.
Convener, I think the simple answer is neither of those two alternatives. Certainly, I think the crack cocaine of gambling is a phrase used primarily by journalists, and there is no clear evidence that gaming machines in betting shops are any more addictive than any other product, any gambling product. If I can make the industry's position absolutely clear, any gambling product has the capacity to cause harm and does cause harm to a minority of our customer base. And so we are quite clear as an industry that it is not an especially addictive product, but at the end of the day, any gambling product does have the capacity to cause harm to a relatively small minority of individuals, and that's why the industry is so focused on harm reduction, which is perhaps a matter we can return to later on in the discussion.
And some of the comments that we've received in response to a survey which we carried out, one of the comments was, just get rid of the things, I'd rather be dead given the financial hole I'm in now.
And I think it's right that we take cognizance of the fact that some people are actually harmed by gambling, and those that have responded. I mean, the industry is very much focused on harm reduction. If one looks at the evidence of problem gambling in Scotland, I think the primary evidence is the Scottish Health Survey, and problem gambling affects about 0.4% of the population. Thankfully, in Scotland, problem gambling is low by international standards, but if one looks at the processes and procedures that are available in betting shops, then they are actually focused on harm reduction. I mean, if one goes into a betting shop, you will find that we fund problem gambling charities, we signpost people to therapy and treatment. We offer self-exclusion in betting shops. And from a William Hill perspective, for example, yes.
Because one of the other things which we found in the survey is someone who said that they've self-excluded themselves from every single shop in the area, but there are points where they still go in, and, you know, there are no discussions with him round about the fact that he self-excluded himself previously.
If we could sort of just examine self-exclusion for a moment. Self-exclusion works for many thousands of people. William Hill has 2,300 shops in Scotland, 2,300 shops in the UK, and we conduct about 500 self-exclusions a month. And if one looks at the whole issue of addiction, the important step with addiction is when someone self-recognises that they do have a problem. And self-exclusion is a way of assisting people to help themselves to control their gambling. Self-exclusion, at the end of the day, is not a golden bullet. People do breach their self-exclusions. But, I mean, from a William Hill perspective, for example, we think we managed to successfully exclude around 80% of people who've self-excluded. So it doesn't mean that people who are determined to gamble don't re-enter the premises. But if you're an addictive gambler, actually you should be seeking therapy and treatment, and self-exclusion is one of a range of tools that we can offer.
Councillor Rooney, please.
Convener, thank you very, very much. This is an area that in Glasgow we took very seriously. We were observing a number of bookmakers. We were getting anecdotal feedback from our communities that there was a growing concern about fixed odd betting tournaments. So in 2014, we undertook a study, and many of the members around the table participated in that survey. In answer to your question, we don't really know is the honest response. That's the reason why in Glasgow, in terms of our cross-party work, we have called for a commission to actually get the independent evidence, I believe, that we all require in order to make a committed position one way or the other. We believe that would allow firm policy to be put in place that obviously assists in terms of supporting those who wish to gamble, but also to make sure we protect those who are vulnerable and have problems and have issues, as you've already outlined. What is quite clear is that in terms of these machines, there are some significant differences already. The amount bet and gambled on these machines is actually greater than the combined total for any other form of gambling. So it's important to remember when we talk about horse racing and football coupons, that and indeed the fact is that more has been gambled in terms of these machines. We are clearly concerned in terms of the speed of play of these machines, the level of stake, and of course the number. In Glasgow we have now 800 fixed odd betting terminals and the 200 bookmakers, so that's certainly more than one in every community in the city. An average convener, we have established that the average bet is £12 every 35 seconds on one of these machines. And the truth of the matter is that we don't actually know what impact they're having. We do know they're popular, we do know they're growing, and we believe that this is an opportunity for Scotland to actually lead in terms of having an understanding of that. At that point, everyone round the table can say with confidence the impact of these machines and to actually answer that very pertinent question that you've asked this morning.
Mr. Zarb Cousin, please.
Thank you. So what we've just heard from Mr. Lyman is an attempt to propagate this idea that gambling-related harm is experienced by a minority of what are termed problem gamblers or faulty individuals. And that really does contradict international evidence, which shows that gambling-related harm is caused by a multitude of factors, including the product, its environment, and to some extent, of course, an individual's predisposition to it. Going back to the original question, whether or not these machines are the crack cocaine of gambling, if we go back to the two most recent British gambling prevalence surveys in 2007 and 2010, secondary research on the 2007 British gambling prevalence survey found that fixed odds betting terminals were the only form of gambling that were statistically significantly associated with disordered gambling, more so than any other type of gambling. And the secondary research carried out on the 2010 British gambling prevalence survey found that 40% of gambling profits come from 40% of FOBT profits come from people who are either problem gamblers or at-risk gamblers. And profits from problem or at-risk gamblers, from FOBTs, are more than several leading gambling activities combined. So this is the type of gambling that problem and at-risk gamblers gamble on the most, they lose the most on, and the £100 stake facilitates harm. So it allows a user to stake up beyond their means if they're starting to chase their losses, or if they win a bit and then they become desensitized to lower stakes. The range from £1 to £100 means that they can stake up from what is affordable in the first instance to an unaffordable level. So that's why we're campaigning for a reduction in the maximum stake. Obviously, I know that power isn't going to be devolved, but this product is significantly associated with harm. And the research from the Responsible Gambling Trust found that 37% of users experience harm while playing them. So it is about the product as well. And I think that's what the industry needs to recognize when if they talk about responsible gambling. It's not just about gamblers gambling responsibly, it's about the industry behaving responsibly, and are they doing so by offering a product where you can lose £300 a minute?
Mr. Scholarios, please.
Just wanted to put in the record the context of the casino, these machines in casinos, just to give an idea. I think the point has been made that the environment is a very important factor, and how the environment basically monitors the machines. There's a total of, in Scotland, there's only 10 FOBTs in the 14 casinos in Scotland. And the level of interaction between the customers and the managers and staff that are there to supervise the play of these machines and any problems that may arise out of the way that certain individuals gamble is on a completely different level. We also have a self-exclusion scheme. It's a mandatory self-exclusion scheme for all National Casino Forum members, and it's independently audited. I think the evidence is that it's almost totally observed. So it's really just a question of these are machines. All gambling has to be monitored. Has to be managed responsibly within the casinos. All the safeguards are there, and is given the seriousness that it deserves. I think it's the level of manpower, the level of supervision is the key thing.
So, just for the record, 10 FOBT machines in the 14 casinos in Scotland.
That's
you said.
Correct. Yeah.
Thank you, Councillor John McAlpine, please.
Thank you.
No, you don't.
Thank you, Convener. On behalf of Gaelic Bute Council, I'd just like to thank you for the opportunity to speak here today. The most important statistic I see in all information we have here is the comments that we have from the members of the public who have actually come back and said what this is doing to their lives and doing to their families. I think that's the crux of the whole matter. And I think, for example, I think there's a lack of knowledge within councils, within MSPs, MPs, exactly what goes on in bookmaker shops. And it's one of the reasons why I highlighted this to our council, because I don't think they actually got the idea of just exactly how much people were spending in these premises. We're talking more and more about reasons why there's more uptake in food banks, reliance on payday lenders, and why at the moment we have more children in the care system. Now, I'm a member of NHS Highlands Health Board, and I know for a fact that is the case. And we say, well, why is children being affected? But if the main breadwinner of the family is not going home with the money to support his family, then therefore somebody's going to suffer.
Or her family.
Or her family. Yes, that's true. So from that point, I think that we really have to look at it. The industry here is well represented, and it's nice to see that they're all getting on together and they're all singing from the same hymn sheet. But they talk about the treasury and staff wages. Where would that go? Where would the money go? But our local economies are suffering. Our high streets are suffering. Every street you see has got the next second shop is either a bookmaker's or a charity shop. And as a local councillor, I see my role as supporting the local economy. And the money's not going back into the local economy. So I feel that we really have to look at that. I have other things here which we look at. I mean,
I think the other things will come up. Okay. The question still basically is crack cocaine or a harmless bit of fun?
Thanks, convener. Well, in my opinion, it is the crack cocaine, and it's no longer fun.
Thank you. Mr. Heaton, please.
Convener, you introduced me as a member of the ABB, which is true, but I'm also chairman of Scotbet, which is Scotland's largest independent betting chain. And to echo some of the comments made by Mr. Lyman, clearly there is an issue here. We do recognise that, and certainly at Scotbet, we have joined Senate, and we've done all that we can to make sure that if there is any problem gambling in our shops, it's addressed. Now, there's a lot of comment about the amount that these machines take, and I give you the facts. I have three in my shops on average. We're allowed four. Frankly, they don't pay enough for me to put four in. We take, on average, per machine, £425, which is a lot less than some of the numbers that I hear bandied about. Now, these are Scottish numbers. I'm giving you my figures. I take, in terms of profit, I make about 35-37% from the machines. I don't make more from machines than I do from sportsbook. Recently, I've had to close 8 shops because they were simply not able to pay for themselves. Sadly, the group has gone down from 75. We're currently now at 49, and there's probably 4 or 5 that are already looking likely to close. So the idea that somehow we're targeting the less well-off, that we are making fortunes out of the machines, is simply not borne out by the facts, as far as I'm concerned.
It's maybe the fact that you're closing shops because some of your competitors are clustering around your current businesses, as we seem to see in various places.
Unfortunately not, convenient. The most of the shops that I have been forced to close were in areas where they didn't have competition.
On that point, Councillor Rooney.
To come back in, it's just to ensure that the committee is aware that the figures I've quoted are available publicly. They come from the operators of the machine that was contained in the survey that Glasgow City Council published back in June 2014. So the figures that I've referred to and the wider impact and the stakes being gambled in Scotland is available to committee and to the public in Scotland and verifiable. So whilst I can't discuss individual cases and bookmakers and machines, I can give you a context of one city and Scotland as a whole.
Thank you for that clarification. We'll come back to the sighting of shops and things later, I'm sure. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I just ask you to comment on the effectiveness of the Senate group and how effective it is to curb regulating gambling? It's a group that promotes responsible gambling standards. And I just wondered if people could comment about the Senate group.
Well, let's finish off, Cameron. We'll come back to that point.
Okay.
But I want to give the folks the opportunity to answer the first question because we're still not quite there. Simon Thomas, please.
Thank you, convener. Crack cocaine is a very emotive term, but actually the FOBTs are quite an emotive product. And to be honest, I've been involved in the gambling industry for over 30 years. I've never come across a situation where any one product is causing so much noise. It is impossible that there is not a problem associated with machines. Now, to prove it definitively will be like the lung cancer. There's no causal link between smoking and lung cancer debate that went on for years whilst everyone knew it was a problem. But when you put the situation in a common sense context, gambling worldwide follows a pattern with a pyramid of regulation and player protection supervision. At the very top, you have casinos, where the hard gambling exists. People know they're going to a casino. It's a destination. They go with a budget in mind. There's very effective door control to keep young people out. There's very effective supervision. I have the largest casino in London. I employ 600 staff. I have over 250 staff that are trained in problem gambling awareness. My failure rate of letting under 18-year-olds in is zero, and I'm very proud of that. And it works. And yet we have machines, slot machines that play at £5 a game, and our roulette runs at about one game every 100 seconds. At the bottom of this regulatory pyramid, you have seaside arcades, and whether or not you think children should gamble or not, there are low supervision environments where you have the penny falls and things like that where children can play. And then in the middle, traditionally worldwide, you have the ambient high street gambling, bingo halls, arcades, betting shops, and worldwide the average stake is around £2 per game. And they are lower supervision environments where gambling is ambient. We've got a situation in the UK which is it is so out of kilter with the rest of the world to have £100 a go roulette machines playing a game every 20 seconds on the high street in easily available site. It is not surprising it's causing a problem. And when the figures are quoted of national figures, averages, as soon as somebody starts talking national average, you have to go a little bit deeper. The prevalence study said that 11% of people playing FOB Ts had were problem gamblers. And when you actually look at problem gambling, the law says we have to protect the young and vulnerable. It does not talk about problem gamblers. Problem gamblers are the end of the scale. There's a huge chunk of problematic gamblers, like a binge drinker, somebody who will go in with their £300 wages and all of a sudden they've spent their money. Now, they're not a problem gambler, but that machine has caused a major problem to them and their families. And that sort of level of gambling should not be allowed in easily accessible high street locations. When bookmakers did not have them, they were very nice environments. They were places where people would go and have a fiver on the horses, and it was fairly benign. Now you've got a situation where 97% of call-outs to gambling premises are by the police are to betting shops, where you've got thousands of machines smashed up every year by irate gamblers who have lost control. You've got situations in the press on a regular basis. There was a suicide from a chap in Aberdeen citing the FOB Ts as an issue. They're without question a problem, and I admire Scotland for actually taking a stance, and hopefully the rest of the UK will follow.
Thank you. Mr. Lyman, is it in the original point?
Yes, it is. We firmly believe that problem gambling is about the person, not the product. And we think if Scotland is to fashion a sensible harm reduction policy as far as problem gambling is concerned, that it doesn't concentrate on a single product in a single sector, but it has a coordinated view around all gambling products. And if one looks at the facts, the Scottish Health Survey tells us that about 1 in 20 regular bettors and gamers that goes into a betting shop may have a problem. But the Scottish Health Survey also tells us that about 13% of multi-product gamblers, those gamble on 6 or 7 different products across different gambling sectors, have a larger problem. So I think it's right that we discuss gaming machines in betting shops, but I think a more sensible approach is to look at a harm reduction policy across all products and concentrate on the person and not the product.
What would you say in response to Mr. Thomas, who obviously is involved in another part of the gambling industry, but obviously has some experience, and the comments that he has just made about the dangers of these FOB T machines and where they're located?
They're a popular product. They're a digital product.
Just because they're popular doesn't mean to say they're right. Crack cocaine is popular amongst some folk, as we well know.
But at the end of the day, Convener, with respect, it's a question of proportionality. And I've heard the figures from Councillor Rooney and the figures from Mr. Heaton. Around 40% of William Hill's profits come from gaming machines. Around 60% comes from traditional over-the-counter products. And we have problem gamblers across the range of products. So at the end of the day, this idea that gaming machines are particularly addictive is simply not borne out by the evidence, the Scottish Government's own evidence from the health survey.
Well, I'm not going to defend the accuracy or not of the health survey, and I think that in some regards, in terms of survey work, when it comes to addiction, some people try to hide that addiction, and we know that all too well. I'm going to take John Wilson now, please.
It's just on the original point. Now, one of the submissions that we received from the questionnaire that the committee put out was the point about the use of FOBTs, and the individual makes point about the worst harm I have suffered has come from using my debit card on FOBTs. When my daily cash withdrawal limit from the ATM has been exceeded, I can go into any bookmakers and use my debit card on an FOBT without any limits. Surely that's feeding the addiction, and it's uncontrolled addiction if people can actually go into those FOBTs and actually just use a debit card.
First of all, betting shops don't accept credit cards, and one cannot use a debit card directly into a gaming machine. Right. The only way that one can use a debit card is to present the debit card to the colleague in the betting shop and ask for some credit to be put on the machine. But we're quite clear now that actually use of debit cards...
Can I stop you there, Mr. Lyman? And you will stop when I speak, because I am the chair. You've just said originally that you cannot use debit cards in shops, and then you said machine... No, I get the credit card point, but then you said you cannot use it in machines, and then you said that you could go to a colleague in store and get the credit off of that debit card. Now, it's either one or t'other. People can either do this or not do this, because you seem to dismiss the original point that was being made by Mr. Wilson.
I'm certainly not dismissive of the point. What I was merely trying to explain was the process. And when one hands a debit card over the counter, it's a legitimate form of payment. Many people don't carry a huge amount of cash now and actually prefer to use a debit card rather than carrying large amounts of cash. Repeated debit card use is an identifiable marker of harm, and certainly in our shops, our staff are instructed that when someone is using a debit card repeatedly for either over-the-counter betting or for gaming machine use, that is an opportunity to conduct a responsible gambling interaction with that particular individual.
Okay. Mr. Storer, is it still on this point? Because I want to get to Mr. Buchanan's question.
Convener, yes it is, please.
Okay, on you go.
Thank you very much. I think we can bandy figures around and use them to support our particular position. But I think that, and I know that the Bookies and others have brought in a number of schemes to protect the vulnerable and do all the things they say. But the fact is that if we had known then, when these machines were brought in, what we know now, they wouldn't be allowed. And I think that's the key thing as to whether they are the crack cocaine or whether they're harmless gaming. Clearly, the machines have caused a huge amount of problems. It's obvious from the coverage there's been nothing but negative stories for many, many months, if not more than a year, on these stories. I've not read anything that's positive about them. Most political groups within the UK, most local authorities, most groups are anti them. So we can argue and use figures to support them and say, well, we're doing everything we can to protect the vulnerable and they don't cause the problem they do. Well, clearly the majority think otherwise. And as I say, if we had known the knowledge that we now know, then would they have been accepted? And the answer is no, they wouldn't. And therefore, that must be the key issue as to whether they are actually a problem or not a problem.
Thank you. I'm going to come to Mr. Buchanan's question now about Senate. Do you want to give us the gist of it again, please, Cameron?
Fine. Thank you, Convener. Senate is the promoting responsible gambling standards, and it's not everybody has to belong to it, as I understand it. And I wondered if you would comment on what Senate actually achieves in this sense, because it says when the fun stops, stop on their TV advertisements, but does it?
Anyone want to answer that? I'll take Mr. Zarb-Cousin first, please.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is part of an overarching strategy from the betting industry to introduce this issue to one of individual responsibility and not about the industry's responsibility to provide products that are safe and enjoyable. It's one thing to say when the fun stops, stop, but if the funds stop, if you're addicted, it's a lot more difficult than that. You know, you're already addicted. I personally got addicted to fixed odds betting terminals at the age of 16. I lost more than £16,000 and got into a lot of debt on them. And if it was as easy as knowing, well, the funds stopped, I better stop now, then I wouldn't have got into that situation. So I'm quite sceptical of the efficacy of these sorts of advertising campaigns. I do think that it'd be more productive to put restrictions on products and bring them into line with the machines that are found elsewhere on the high street.
Thank you. Mr. Heaton, please.
Yes, we joined Senate voluntarily because I felt that we do have a responsibility to our customers. And as far as Senate is concerned, we have removed all advertising material from our windows about the machines. We have responsible gambling messages in the windows. And we have organised the TV campaign. And I accept that for some people, a TV campaign messages about problem gambling may just wash over and they are addicted and have a problem with a wide range of gambling products. But what we're trying to do is to stop people coming into our shops who might ultimately have a problem with gambling. And I think that we have worked hard and our staff work hard to make sure that if they do see someone in shops who might have a problem, that they interact with them.
Okay. Councillor McAlpine, please.
Yeah, that's interesting what you say there, because in Argyll and Bute you have one premise in Campbelltown. And that premise there, for example, there are four machines in that shop, albeit you say mostly shops have three. I could go into that shop and play any machine and the cashier would not even know I was playing these machines because they're not even in sight. Not even in sight of the cashier. So therefore, unlike casinos where you go and you sign in at the door, you're pictured, you're either signed in by a guest or you sign a guest in, they vet you. These places, you don't have any knowledge of what's going on. But in regards to the interaction, which Mr. Lyman mentioned earlier on, I think there's an issue here with staff safety. Because if, for example, someone has can access £300 from their bank, and that's the limit for a day, and they go to one of your shops and they deposit or they lift, say, £800 from the cashier, what is the limit that you would give them, and at what point would a member of staff approach someone in the shop and say to them, I think you've spent enough? So from that point of view, I think you're putting your staff at risk, because that person's not wanting to leave at that point, and I think you really have to consider the staff safety, and I don't think it's responsible interaction to expect maybe a single female or male late at night to go and approach that person and ask them to stop gambling because they're wanting to recover what they've lost.
John Wilson.
Thank you, Convener. Just on that issue about we've heard about interventions, we've heard about interactions between staff and users of those machines. Mr. Lyman made reference to it, and what I would like to know is, do you record how many interactions or interventions that your colleagues make in relation to where you identify problem users of those machines? Because we've heard that colleagues will monitor, in terms of the William Hill situation, the use of the withdrawals from the debit cards or credits for the use of the machines. How do you monitor and how do you record the interactions that are taking place, and how do you do signposting if you actually find you may have a problem gambler using those machines?
Okay, I've got Mr. Scholarios next, please.
Just to say that in casinos we have a very formalised process for recording all interactions, and they have to be the evidence has to be available for the authorities to audit and independently. And I think just in a general point, in terms of the machines, we accept that they're a hard gaming product. I think that's the point that Mr. Thomas has been putting across as well. We accept that they're a hard gaming product, and we in the casino industry believe very strongly that our customers need to be not so much given total left to their own devices. We believe that our customers need to be helped as well, and on many occasions will be advised to discontinue their gambling and will be helped to restrict, put restrictions on their gambling. The general point being that casinos are very, very highly regulated, intensively regulated, and we feel that is where these machines really belong, if they belong.
Mr. Thomas, please.
Thank you. The Senate group is recognised by the rest of the industry as a well-meaning but bookmaker, it's 100% bookmaker membership smokescreen for the FOBT activity. The people in the Senate are good people, but the issue is not being addressed that it is not all about the player. That's a very convenient argument for the bookmakers. Professor Mark Griffiths in 2005 said that problem gambling is product, location, and player. Hence why you have that pyramid of regulation that hard products have to be in well-supervised locations where the player is protected. The bookmakers have developed a new code through Senate. It's been judged by the Responsible Gambling Trust as ineffective. We have lots of talk of self-exclusion. Firstly, if huge amounts of people are self-excluding, there's got to be a problem. The Gambling Commission statistics said that the number of people self-excluding from bookies had jumped over the last few years from 20,000 to 28,000, but there are 21,000 breaches. The bookmakers are doing schemes where they're doing broadening out self-exclusion across a whole region. Medway was the first trial where you can self-exclude from all the shops in Medway. A recent check on it said there was an 80% failure rate. And it all comes down to complete lack of supervision. And when the bookmakers have opened 2% more shops, that doesn't sound a lot, but their bookmaker opening hours have gone from being around the horse racing time of sort of 10 till 6. They're generally open from 7, 7.30 in the morning till as late as 11 o'clock at night. So the number of hours have gone up dramatically, and yet the number of staff have dropped by 8,000 in bookmakers. And it is frequently you have single manning in bookmakers. One of the chains does not allow its staff out of their protected cage after 6.30 at night. I'm not quite sure how they are supposed to interact with customers and say, hey, Johnny, I think you might be spending too much money. It just doesn't happen. It's more of this smoke screen. Hard gambling should be in highly supervised locations, and FOBTs are not the right, not in the right location. Ironically, there are, I think there's 180 FOBTs in casinos. If anywhere, they should be in casinos. I personally think they're too hard for a casino. £100 spin on a 20-second spin. It's fast, hard gambling. But if anywhere, they should be in casinos because we do have active control, active supervision. We don't actually have membership anymore. You can walk straight in. But you walk in through a doorman. You go through a reception area. And all the gambling is face-to-face. And even on the slot machines and electronic gaming terminals, there are slot hosts going round all the time. We don't have staff behind cages because it's such a dangerous environment. Our staff are out on the floor.
Mr. Lyman, please.
To answer Mr. Wilson's question, I think he raised two issues. One was reporting and one was staff safety. Certainly from a William Hill point of view, and I don't think we're much different from any of the other major bookmakers, we have a comprehensive reporting system within our shops and a central compliance team that monitors all of that reporting. So in a shop, for example, you report the number of age verification challenges you make, you report the number of responsible gambling interactions that you have by way of narrative. That narrative is then recorded centrally. And the figures that I gave you from a sort of UK basis for 4,700 responsible gambling interactions a month and 500 self-exclusions a month are figures that are gathered from our central reporting system. We even monitor shops to find out whether those shops have failed to report, and then we challenge those shops if they haven't reported any incidents on the basis that we would expect at least responsible gambling interactions to be taking in a shop, and if a shop isn't reporting at the sort of expected level, then we would challenge the shop and the management around that issue. So reporting in betting shops is fairly comprehensive, and indeed, you know, in betting shops, the supervision of machines is a priority. One thing that we haven't got to yet, of course, is the legislative change of the £50 restriction around gaming machines. So if you now want to play a gaming machine at above £50, you have to do that A, by registered play, or B, by handing the money over the counter. You can't load the machine if you want to spin it more than £50. So there is a very significant restriction and an opportunity for interaction with the customers on that particular issue. So monitoring and supervision is as strong in the betting industry as it is in the casino sector and any other sector. I don't pretend we're any better or any worse, but the idea that we are less supervised or that regulation is lighter in the betting industry is a complete misnomer.
Sir Thomas's point that at points staff and certain bookmakers kind of get out of their cage, so how can that supervision be taking place?
Well, one has to look at other control measures. For instance, within the William Hill estate, we have a third-party monitoring system within all of our high and medium-risk shops. And by quarter one of next year, we will have a third-party monitoring system in all of our shops. So if people are lone working, then if there is any problem, they can actually sound an alarm or the monitoring
and
services.
And that's all fine, and that's for the protection of your staff, and I understand yes. that. But how can they monitor problem gamblers if they're locked in a cage?
Well, first of all, the machines are controlled from behind the counter, so uh-huh. all the machines can be disabled from behind the counter. I've said that.
I've seen this. I actually watched a programme about Coral bookmakers that was on lately, where it has to be said those machines were very rarely used. But cutting somebody off at a point is actually going to cause a huge amount of grief for your staff, who you've already said are, in these occasions, lone workers. Is it likely that they're going to cut off those machines knowing that it might all kick off?
I mean, there's obviously a right and a wrong time for intervention, convener, but in the majority of cases, our staff carry out effective, responsible gambling interactions across the piece. There will be people that, you know, every retail unit has someone in it whose mother never taught them any manners, and so there will be difficult people that go into betting shops from time to time. But our staff are experienced, and they do get the support if we have a difficult customer. For example, it may be inappropriate to challenge a customer at a particular point in time, but the challenge then can be delivered the following morning when that customer comes into the betting shop again, or the district manager can be called to go down and speak to that customer.
Is in last thing at night when there's a lone worker, and then we'll be in first thing in the morning. That kind of situation actually sums up where I think the difficulty in all of this is. Councillor Rooney, please.
Thank you very much. As part of our research last year, we did speak with trade union representatives and staff representatives who were concerned about the single working fin stores, and the situations that have been referred to are not uncommon, where you have a single member of staff who has been asked to increasingly make those interventions and to actually take the responsibility of ensuring that the welfare of the gambler is upheld. And for me, that is very questionable going forward. We asked the question initially about whether the crack cocaine of gambling, I'm certainly content, as our colleagues in Glasgow City Council, will determine mini casinos, because they are mini casinos. It's a question of whether or not they are appropriate for communities across Scotland. Clearly, our position is that this is a public health issue. Gambling is a public health issue, and it should be treated as such. I think the tragic circumstances that we referred to earlier in the meeting that were reported in the last few weeks demonstrate again that there's a lack of structured support for people who have gambling problems. I feel it's appropriate that at this time that we acknowledge during this discussion that there is a problem. I think what we need is an understanding of what the harm is, and thereafter to make sure that we have the appropriate balances in place. What we've heard again from the industry this morning actually reassures my position that self-regulation is not the way forward. Convener, you're hearing again the industry are saying that they are using advertising, they are making more interventions than ever, but what we're not hearing is the difference that that's making. And I think what we require in Scotland is the ability to get that independent piece of research, and my offer to everyone around the table is to support that position, and that way all of us, when we reconvene, can actually be reassured that we have got safeguards for people who have gambling problems and where fixed odd betting terminals fit into that.
Okay. I've got a number of folk who have signalled, and some of them want to come in on specific points. Willie, was yours a specific point on something that's come up or on this?
I just wanted to ask about the technology side of this.
Can I come back to you in that regard then? John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just to go back to Mr. Lyman's figures, Mr. Lyman, you made reference to 4,500 interventions by your colleagues in a month. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So that, and that's the UK-wide figures. So if we extrapolate those figures and then translate them into what would normally be seen as Scottish figures, we're talking about almost 5,000 interventions a year.
That would be right.
In Scotland. Is that recurring interventions or is that individual interventions within, you know, individuals coming into the shop and then being excluded from the shop?
Some of those interventions will be in respect of the same individual. And those interventions cover a whole wide spectrum, because problem gambling covers a whole wide spectrum. There is addictive gambling, which is the top end, which affects a very small percentage of gamblers. And then there are those, I think as Mr. Zarb Cousin mentioned, those people who just simply spend too much time and money gambling. And the issue is that the intervention will be appropriate to what has happened in the shop. Some of those interventions may be customer generated. A customer may say, I've spent too much money, don't ever let me in here again. In which case we would point out how self-exclusion would take place. So, I think at the end of the day, one can use those statistics as a stick to beat the industry with. But we're really proud of the fact that we do make positive interventions with customers, and customers do self-exclude from our shops, and we actually help the minority of people who suffer from problem gambling.
Mr. Zarb Cousin, is it still on this point? Yes.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Thanks, yeah. Convener. It's also on the, because Mr. Lyman mentioned the government's measure where you have to now sign up to a loyalty card if you want to bet more than £50 a spin or identify yourself to staff, and alluded to the fact that this would be a better opportunity for interaction. Well, what's actually happened, friends of mine have signed up to the loyalty cards, and in a display of egregious opportunism, as we've come to expect from the bookmakers, they have started to bombard these people with text message marketing. Now, bearing in mind that the government introduced this measure on the basis that, on the assumption that people who are betting more than £50 a spin are more likely to be the players experiencing the most harm, it's slightly irresponsible, I think, to say the least, to start bombarding these players with text message marketing. And the second issue as well is on the code of conduct. Now, when the code of conduct was introduced in April 2013, it was billed as world-leading, and this would give customers the opportunity to set their limits and set time and spend restrictions. But obviously, the problem with it was when you reach the time and spend restrictions, you would get a message and it would say, do you want to continue? And you could just press yes and carry on. The RGT commissioned an evaluation of this code of conduct. It was far from world leading. By December 2014, just 1,500 out of 4 million sessions used limit setting. And those that did set limits set them between £350 and £450. So self-regulation is not the solution. It makes no sense to invest all this time and resource into mopping up the problems caused by this particular product. You might as well just deal with the product, reduce the harm that way, and then you don't have to then try and clean up the mess that it's created.
Mr. Storer, please.
Thank you. I also wanted to talk about the £50 regulation issue that's just been covered, and I'll add a little bit to what's already been said. When it was brought in, it was a sensible move from the government to look at how they can begin to control some of the problems that were there. And I'm sure Mr. Lynham's company have endorsed it and run it very successfully. However, we know that a number of bookmakers have used it as a marketing tool, by signing up to it, you give your mobile number, and therefore you are open to this marketing. Texts such as "Big men bet big" have been used by the bookies to encourage people to continue to bet. So I think it's very disingenuous to assume that all of them have taken this scheme on board in a sensible and way to try and actually deal with this problem. So there's a lot of evidence that showed that it has been used very disingenuously.
Big men, bet big. Do you think that would get Senate advertising approval?
You must ask them.
I've got one thing before we move off to Senate and off the Senate subject and move on to Willie Coffey. I'd never heard of Senate, to have to be honest with you, until very recent times, where suddenly they wanted to talk to me. I wonder why that is. And when I said no, not until after this inquiry was dealt with, because everybody has got the ability to put in written submissions and maybe be called to give evidence. I have to say that the response was fairly aggressive. Does that really strike bode well for an organisation that is supposed to be dealing with trying to resolve problem gambling from the industry's perspective? And I'll ask Mr. Heaton and Mr. Lyman that. Mr. Heaton.
Well, you may not have heard of Senate, sir, but in fact, you will have seen all the advertising that has been paid for by Senate, and it wasn't branded Senate, but it nevertheless has been.
No, but that was not my question. It's the fact that they make contact with you for the first time ever. A cynic would maybe say it's because we're conducting this inquiry, and on this occasion I am a cynic.
Well, I apologise for the reaction that you appear to have got from Senate. They are... We have tried to make sure that it's an independent organisation. The board are all independent, the management are independent, and if you feel that they've been overly aggressive, then we'll certainly take that back.
Mr. Lyman.
I think, Convener, there's a place for self-regulation, and Senate and the Association of British Bookmakers are very focused on self-regulation. But I think it's also important to record that the industry is proud to be part of a regulated sector. And I think it's good that we're sitting around the table talking about statistics, being held to account by you and your other colleagues. But I think that, you know, one of the points that we've missed is that the fact is that these machines are supplied by a heavily regulated sector.
We're moving off, and I want to finish this part first and then get on to Mr. Coffey. Right, in terms of no, does the betting industry understand the term no? I'll give you my example here, because none of your industry has been really interested in what I've had to say previously, and then suddenly they're all over you like a rash. And when I have said, no, I will not be meeting anyone during the course of this inquiry because you have the ability to submit written evidence and then may be called to give evidence, your folk don't quit, do they?
Well, Convener, I think it's probably right that you said no because you have to main objective because you're chairing this committee. So I fully understand why you said to previous approaches.
So why is it that after I'd said no... to William Hill, that during the course of my party conference in Aberdeen, one of your folk went out of their way to try and find me and speak to me?
I wasn't at that particular event, Convener, so I don't know, but I can see that you're objectively chairing this particular committee.
Mr. Buchanan. Sorry,
just a quick point. I gather that to be a member of Senate is voluntary. It's not compulsory. Not all gambling people are members of Senate. Is that correct?
Okay. Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. I was hoping to ask colleagues a wee bit more about the technology side of this business. We heard some questions being opened up by Mr. Wilson there that I think take me down this pathway. Can more be done with the technology to protect people? It seems to me that the sophistication in the machines, and they are very sophisticated, is all focused on the experience that a person might have and the enticement to gamble, and perhaps less so of a focus on the protection of the individual. So how can technology, or could technology be better deployed to protect people from making increasingly more mistakes? Because the figures I heard are quite worrying, Convener. We heard Mr. Zab-Cousin saying that a person can lose £300 a minute. We heard Councillor Rooney saying that the average bet is £12 every 35 seconds. Surely the technology could be deployed in a wee bit more of a sophisticated fashion to protect people. So I appreciate ideas on that.
I can talk about the technology in betting.
Mr. Lyman.
To be honest. If one goes back to the £50 restriction, what betting shop operators on at the moment are focused on registered play, because one of the challenges in betting shops is that obviously a lot of the play is anonymous and therefore it's difficult to profile customers. We are encouraging registered play, and Mr. Zab-Cousins has talked about the card and how customers are messaged. We are currently in a trial where the Responsible Gambling Trust have identified the potential markers of harm of gambling. We have developed algorithms which are obviously being trialled on both our online site and on our gaming machines to identify harmful patterns of play. And I use, for example, the example where, for example, increases in turnover for a customer or something like that. So if it's registered, you can say that. What we are now doing is running a trial where we are messaging those customers who on our algorithm are engaged in potentially harmful play. And the trials so far are suggesting that that is working well, that around 60% of customers who are messaged, who are engaging in registered play, are actually changing their behaviour. They're actually staking down or staking less or gambling less frequently. So we're really encouraged by those trials. They're taking place online, they're taking place in retail, and the Responsible Gambling Trust have recently commissioned research to help us develop that approach to technology. And I think it's absolutely right that the industry should be held into account. We're a technological industry. We're providing a digital product both in retail and in online, and it is right that we should develop technological solutions to identify harmful patterns of play and then to be able to react with those customers and help them to change their behaviour. It's in its infancy, but it is happening and it is meaningful and it is working.
Can I ask you a question, Mr. Lyman? Because in this room, there is somebody who likes a wee flutter, shall we say.
Yes.
Mainly online betting.
Yes.
Not a big gambler.
No.
But he wins almost all of the time. Now, the bookies have developed the technology to ban that person from betting in certain sites. So if you can develop that technology quickly to deal with and get rid of the small-time gambler who's winning a lot, why can't you just deal with these technologies that you've just talked about with FOBTs right now?
And we are doing that, Convener. We are developing that technology, and we are implementing it within our businesses.
Mr. Zarb-Cousin, please.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, on this particular algorithm that the gambling the Responsible Gambling Trust commissioned Feature Space to investigate, which is a commercial company. The Gambling Commission noted that a significant proportion of problem gamblers still remained unidentified from the patterns of play that were supposed to indicate problem gambling. So the algorithm is, as Mr. Lyman says, certainly in its infancy. I'd say probably about 10 years away from being effective. And it doesn't really go to the crux of it, which is that you can identify harmful patterns of play, but you're not addressing what's causing the harm in the first place. And it's a combination of factors. It's the staking range, £1 to £100, the roulette content, which is addictive anyway, but made 5 times faster than in a casino, the fact that it's a solitary activity. There's a range of factors that make this a particularly harmful product, and reducing the stake would limit that harm. There's no good identifying harmful patterns of play if once you've identified people experiencing harm, you don't know what to do once you have identified those people. There's very little research or work that's gone into, on the industry side, gone into actually finding out what would be effective in terms of an intervention.
Mr. Thomas, please.
Thank you. Problem gambling and algorithm. It's a lovely nirvana. It's a very nice way of pushing the problem down the line for another 5 or 10 years. The University of Las Vegas produced a paper a short while ago that made it very clear that an algorithm is not the solution. When you look at the test for problem gambling, the current one is called DSM-5. It has a number of checks. They are things like, have you missed time from work? Has your gambling caused you arguments? Do you borrow money to gamble? And these are all the real-world things you pick up through supervision of the player, human supervision. And you cannot pick them up through an algorithm. The potential for an algorithm is fairly small. I'm happy to copy you the paper from University of Las Vegas. It is very low. And I think you quite correctly identified also the algorithm. There's a bit of divided loyalty. I'm sure the bookies are putting lots of money into algorithms, but the algorithms are used to promote the business. In the same way, I too joined, I'm actually M Mouse and D Duck in two of the bookmakers, gave my phone number and email address. I'm bombarded daily with adverts pressure to spend money offers. That is not exactly the way to promote, to use technology. And additionally, the staff who are supposed to carry out all of this supervision and player interaction following any algorithm popping up from behind their bandit screen, in some of the bookmakers, they're also incentivized on the machine's performance. So beside being probably on minimum wage, late at night, often female, with a lot of things to do, they're supposed to do all this, and they're also told you're going to get more money if those machines take more money. It doesn't add up.
Okay, does anybody else want to come in on the technology point then? Councillor Rooney.
Thank you. Just very quickly, just to respond to Mr. Coffey's question, I mean, quite rightly, he's identifying the technology. My response would be the technology is already in place. Part of our consideration in our research is whether or not the required, if we were having such machines, that you have compulsory membership. What that would allow is you would actually be able to monitor exactly the play that's taking place. What you're hearing at the moment is different parts of it, and it's always the individuals that we don't know who perhaps are making the significant losses. I think what I would say going forward is if these machines continue to exist in our communities, then we have to actually have access to that data. As I've already indicated, we have the overall position already stated, and that's giving us an understanding of the losses, even to the extent it's actually £12.86 per average spin. So that's the level of detail already exists. The industry know their customers very well, convener. I think the difficulty is those who are not part of the industry need to get that understanding.
You talked about communities there, and some of the written submissions that we have, it seems that bookmakers seem to be clustered in certain communities, city centres, but poorer communities. You don't see many bookies in the west end of Aberdeen, it has to be said, from my observations. It's been said by some that planning policy should be used to deal with that situation, but we all know that that's almost nigh near impossible. Do you have any comment on the cluster or the planning aspects?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, in terms of planning, my first observation is if you look in most communities in Scotland, you will see a clustering effect. If I may speak about my own community, Knightswood in Glasgow, there are three bookmakers in one row of shops. That is the reality. So each of those bookmakers has four fixed odd betting terminals. So
each of them has four?
Four, yes.
So 12 in one parade of shops?
Yes. That's the position just in one community in Glasgow. I've already made the committee aware of the fact that we have 200 bookmakers in Glasgow, 800 fixed odd betting terms. So that is the scale. My position and the position of the council, as I've said on a few occasions, is a cross-party position we have taken around this, is we want to do whatever we can at local government level. We also clearly require the support of governments, both at Scottish and UK level. Clearly, we would like to make sure that the powers are with local government to ensure that appropriate decisions are taken. There still remains issues around categorisation of bookmakers as opposed to other categories and such as banks. And that is something that I believe we can address and address quickly. So the complexities of this discussion we are hearing this morning, it's not straightforward to actually say it's one thing or another. It's actually a combination of things. And that's why I continue to reiterate that position of having that independent research and where a commission would support a position going forward. And that's without taking a step back from my pragmatic approach, which is to work with campaigners and the industry, but without that independent research, convener, it's very difficult to make firm conclusions.
So instead of us just carrying out this inquiry into FOBTs, you would like to see a broader discussion about the movement of power from government, whether that be Westminster or here, to local government, to allow you to have more of a say in what's going on in this particular industry.
Convener, if I could just quickly respond, my position is always that the power should sit at the appropriate level. On this occasion, I certainly believe that local government is best placed to make decisions on planning matters associated with the appropriateness of bookmakers, and that certainly is a position where we see voids are replaced by bookmakers, despite the fact there may be one or more bookmakers in the close proximity already.
But it's been argued that the planning system alone is not enough in terms of being able to regulate goods and services.
My position is that when we're talking about fixed odd betting terminals per se, it's a range of issues. It includes planning and licensing. And the point I'm making here, Convener, is that we have to understand those complexities in order to actually get the appropriate policy going forward.
Councillor McAlpine, do you want to come in on that point?
Yeah, well, the original question was regarding technology and where it fits in with the fixed odds betting terminals. You know, we had a problem with alcohol in this country. What we did was we actually set time limits on when you could buy alcohol and whatever in the morning or when you could buy it at night. I don't think we need to get into technology. I think we have to look at the men or people queuing up, men or women queuing up at 9 o'clock in the morning to enter a licensed bookies licensed premise. That, to me, would indicate that there is a problem in our communities, and I think staff should pick up on that. And I don't know why we have shops open at 9 o'clock in the morning when sometimes we don't even have shops open at that time. I think we have to try and tighten up the laws on the opening hours of shops as well.
Mr. McGowan, please.
Good morning, Convener. I'm hoping to piggyback onto the comments from Councillor Rooney about local government regulation. It's something I feel I, on behalf of the Law Society, can usually comment on. So if you're with me on perhaps straying away from the technology question, I can comment on that.
I think we've kind of moved away a little bit anyway. So on you go, Mr. McGowan.
I'm grateful. Thank you for that. I would like to make a very important point about local regulation. And that is that the Gambling Act 2005 is a very significant drafting error in it, which the Law Society, the Scottish Government and the Gambling Commission have all tried to have remedied for many years. And that is an error which results in a situation that licensing boards in Scotland, the authorities which issue licences under the Gambling Act, are not entitled to regulate premises. Now, this drafting error relates to the authorisation of officers, licensing officers, who go out to premises and ascertain whether or not they are adhering to the law. And this happens under alcohol licensing and other forms of licensing across the country. But under the Gambling Act, there is a problem because the original Act ignored the fact that in Scotland, licensing of gambling premises is dealt with by the board and not the local authority, because, of course, the licensing board in Scotland is a separate legal entity, as I'm sure most members will be aware. And that situation persists. So to give you one example of the benefit that local regulation may be is that if we do manage to convince the Westminster government to amend the Act, and Ian Murray MP has tried with an amendment, although it wasn't taken forward in the recent Scotland Bill debate, that would allow local officers at local government level to be trained appropriately in relation to the Gambling Act and would allow them to conduct enforcement and compliance activity, which is not being conducted at the moment. The Gambling Act came into force in 2007. Since that time, my understanding is there's been one review of a gambling licence since 2007. Now, that suggests that there is a wide misunderstanding or perhaps fear of what the gambling law is by licensing authorities in Scotland, because they're so busy and focused with alcohol licensing. There is a solution to part of what I suggest are the issues here about local problems, and that is for this committee to hopefully hear what I say and enjoinder the Westminster government to amend the Gambling Act to allow proper local enforcement to be conducted by licensing officers. Thank you.
Convener, we want to work in a well-regulated sector, and if amendments have to be made to give licensing officers the right powers as they have in England, then that should be done forthwith.
I'm sure the committee will take that on board. Mr. McGowan, there's no point in having your expertise here without asking you further. Do you think that there are any other measures available to the Scottish Government at this moment in time or with the new powers about the perceived proliferation of FOBTs?
I think that there is a difficulty overusing terms which are not defined legally. And, of course, that's what you'd expect the Law Society to say, but I think it's a good point, because we prefer law to be made as good law. And if we're using terms such as clustering and proliferation, these terms have to be identified and measured. Now, what I would say is that we would support Councillor Rooney's call for wider research, and that wider research might educate everyone involved in this process as to what those terms may actually mean in reality. Under alcohol licensing, licensing boards are very used to the concept of overprovision, which is the idea that there are too many alcohol licensed premises within a given area. And that is a term which is under the Licensing Act, which is the Alcohol Licensing Act, which is within this Parliament's control. But even at that, there are ongoing cases and disputes over what overprovision may or may not look like, some of which has been addressed recently in the Air Weapons Licensing Act. But it's a very difficult topic to get clarity on unless it's looked at properly and it's based on evidence which is probative. And I think the only way we're going to get to that is by a review which Councillor Rooney suggested, and the committee would support that and certainly has done in its response to this committee.
Can I ask, would there be greater scope to review existing licensing if we had a further look at the Gambling Act?
The existing provisions for review allow licensing boards to call for a licence in on the idea that there is someone somewhere alleging that harm is occurring or that there is a problem. But as I said, in my own experience, I may be wrong, but my own experience, there has only been one such hearing across the 32 licensing boards since 2007, and I put that down to the lack of ability of local government officers to conduct enforcement and compliance processes. But unfortunately, the only way that we can remedy that is by having Westminster amend the Gambling Act itself.
Or for the Gambling Act to be devolved.
Well, that would be a separate solution which would allow this Parliament to then amend the legislation as this Parliament sees fit.
Do we have a difficulty in some regards over this area because there is that division of responsibility?
There are two difficulties with that, Convener. There's a constitutional law difficulty and then there's a licensing law difficulty. If I can focus on the constitutional difficulty, there is a perceived issue with having some premises that are licensed in Scotland controlled by one part of the law, which may be Westminster, and some other machines or other premises which exist in Scotland which would be controlled by other law which may arise as a result of the Scotland Bill. The Law Society's position on that is that is a constitutional problem because it creates a situation where you have perhaps one premises and a premises next door to it and they are both regulated under separate areas of law, and that's not good.
Thank you, Mr. McGowan. Mr. Zarb-Cousin, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just picking up on this point about what constitutes overprovision. So the context within which we operate at the moment has been identified by the Association of Town and City Management, who released a report this year and found that between 2004 and 2012, the number of betting shops in our town and city centres in the UK has increased by 43%, and in Scotland that growth rate has been 80%. And this has been driven by fixed odds betting terminals, which should be an ancillary product to a betting shop's core business of over-the-counter betting. Obviously, for many operators, particularly the corporate operators, they now account for more than 50% of their profits and more than 80% of their turnover. But clustering only occurs, well, certainly in the cases where one operator will open two shops within walking distance of each other. That only occurs because they're trying to increase the number of machines in a particular area, which is driven by what should be an ancillary product. So we obviously support restrictions on this product, and we want to see betting shops return to their core business of betting. We're not an anti-gambling group at all.
We're now getting really tight for time, and I may choose to reconvene depending where we're at. But Mr. Storer?
Convener, thank you. I think as far as the number of betting shops and the number of machines, I think the issue is much more about the level of stake. If the stake was brought down to be in line with other high street activities, the number of shops and the number of machines would become irrelevant. I think it's all to do with the stake, and I would support that we are pushing the British government to bring that in line so that that stake is brought down. And I think a lot of the problem would disappear if that was the case. There would be less reason for them to have so many machines and so many betting shops.
Mr.
So I think
Barron,
the stake is the issue.
I'm aware
issue.
That you haven't contributed. Have you got anything that you wish to say or don't feel forced into it?
No, I thank you for the opportunity. Convener, yeah. May I speak?
Yeah, please.
I'm here to represent the bingo industry in the UK, of which there are 50 bingo clubs in Scotland. We don't currently have FOBT machines, and we don't wish for them. So you may actually ask the question, well, why am I here? Why did we respond to the consultation? Well, I'm here because we are concerned in the bingo industry that any unintended consequences or actions taken around FOBT machines may indeed affect our industry.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas, please.
In terms of what else the Scottish Government can do, I think we're all, perhaps with the exception of the bookmakers, quite convinced there is a problem that needs dealing with. And it isn't clearing up the mess, it's actually going to the core of the problem. Councillor Rooney's absolutely right. The effect on communities is damaging and needs to be addressed. And in the UK, in Britain, 93 councils representing their communities have put forward a Sustainable Communities Act motion asking for the stake on FOBTs to be dropped to £2. The Scottish Government has an amazing network and great power. If it can add pressure to that system, then clearly that would help sort the problem. Lord Tim Clement Jones has got a private members bill going through Lords. Again, if the Scottish guns could be turned to actually support that, it would be very welcome. And if the concern obviously then comes, if the FOBTs are cut down to £2, what happens? There's a couple of reports, one by Landman and one by NERA, that are referred to in my evidence. The NERA report actually said if it goes down to £2, the effect on the communities will be the number of betting shops will reduce, particularly where there are unwelcome clusters, and they thought 700. But the effect on the community would be there'd be 2,000 more jobs on the high street, because money would go either onto over-the-counter, back to the traditional betting, or to other more labour-intensive high street activities. So it would be very positive for the community.
Mr. McGowan, I'll take you if you're very brief.
I just wanted to add a very short comment about planning law, which was mentioned. I forgot to say that. My understanding is this Parliament did look at amending planning law, and it decided in April of this year that there was no change made to planning laws in respect of betting premises. I just thought I should put that on record.
It may be an idea that some of us may want to have discussion with the panel that's currently looking at reviewing planning, if we have anything to say on that point. Can I thank you all for your evidence today? That has been extremely useful. The next meeting of the committee is on Wednesday, the 18th of November, and I now close this meeting. Thank you.